Welcome, everybody, to the Board of Selectmen meeting for today, Tuesday, September 20th. I'd like to call it to order. Let's start with the Pledge of Allegiance. The Pledge of Allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the Republic which stands one nation under God, indivisible, liberty, and justice for all. Thank you for your patience, everyone. We went a little long in executive session where we discussed strategy with respect to litigation in relation to Joe v. Town of Hopkinton because an open meeting may have been detrimental effect on the litigation of the board. Discussed strategy with respect to litigation in relation to Hopkinton Wine and Spirits, again, because an open meeting may have detrimental effect on the litigation of the board. And to discuss strategy relative to the deployment of public safety personnel and equipment or with respect to strategies thereto in connection with Hopco. So with that, we'll look at consider approving executive minutes. I know that we already did that earlier. A public forum. Does anybody want to step up to our new two seats and discuss anything they might have on their mind? Please come on up and introduce yourself and tell us what you think.
Good evening, ladies and gentlemen. My name is Martha Giansanti. My husband George and I live in the Timber Glen development that is right off of Spring Street and borders the Upton State Forest. In our development, it is all private well system. We're here this evening because we are very concerned about the severe drought situation that we're in. And we'd like to ask the board to take very serious and meaningful action in order to help with conservation measures. I have brief points that I'd like to share with you. Specifically, we are very concerned again about just the drought that we are in. And we can see within our own community, as well as we notice with other communities around Hopkinton, where we have families whose wells are running dry, we're getting depleted. And yet at the same time, we have other individuals in similar communities who are watering their lawns. We feel very strongly that we're all in this together, and we're asking the board again to take very meaningful action in order to address this. Specifically, we think that a very strong, meaningful communication strategy is key. I think often when people see signs or perhaps they're reading The Independent, they may not necessarily think that what they're reading applies to them. And certainly after a period of time, people drive by signs. So we think that a very strong, targeted communication plan is in order. For example, it's using all different types of media in order to get the message out to all the residents of Hopkinton. People learn things through many different means, and I think it's reaching a variety of different activities in order to do that. For example, another idea is to contact the local businesses in the area, like Dell, for example, and perhaps have someone from the water department or the Board of Health, you know, go to Dell and talk to them about the severe condition that we're in, perhaps even set up an information booth that can be there on site at the employer to really talk about the impact of what aquifers can have on, you know, one neighborhood to another, and really talk about conservation efforts that can be put in place. Another idea is also to go into the schools and help teach the children about conservation measures. I mean, it's a great idea to have someone who is a hydrologist, for example, can further the STEM efforts, of course, but really talk about and teach, you know, about water conservation. So we think that education is really key, and putting things in place that really pertain to all residents of the community. Again, as I said, I think we're all in this together. Secondly, we would like the board to take action and extend the water restriction ban to those individuals who are on private well systems. We think it is just absolutely critical that we all share in this, and I don't think necessarily the people understand the impact that they have from one well to another, for example, or one aquifer to another. Third, I'd like to ask the board to strengthen the consequences that are in place if people fail to adhere to the restrictions that are in place at this time. So, for example, I think it's critical that people understand for the first time, perhaps, that maybe they shouldn't water their lawns. But certainly for a second time, we think a much more meaningful and stronger penalty, such as a $1,000 fine, would be in order. I mean, listening to, you know, what everyone is saying about the severe drought, we think it is imperative that the actions that we take are commensurate with the severe drought situation that we're all in. A third offense, for example, again, even much stronger, could entail a $10,000 fine and really just public notification of those individuals who, again, for the third time, have not adhered to it. So again, I think it's critical that action be taken that's meaningful to everyone. And lastly, we certainly know that at times when people are drilling for wells, they may have as a last resort use fracking. And I know that the state likes to refer to it as yield enhancement. While I understand the chemicals are not used in the process, talking to some well drillers that were recently in our neighborhood, I understand that fracking or yield enhancement can also impact surrounding wells. I have to admit I was surprised that there is no oversight that is in place for this type of activity. I think we all recognize that people do need, you know, to find water, and you don't know with the fracking or yield enhancement as a positive or negative impact on, you know, surrounding wells. But again, I think it's something that we need to look into and actually put more oversight in place. We all trust that you, as the CEOs of Hopkinton, have the welfare of all the residents, whether they are on the municipal water system or private well system, in order to keep us safe. And so we entrust that you will keep that in mind as you evaluate the severe situation that we're in. Thank you very much for your time this evening.
Thank you very much for coming up. Okay. I think right now we're going to staff recognition. Chief Steve Slayman will present the Board of Selectmen and the town to William R. Miller as our new Deputy Fire Chief. Chief, could you come up and introduce your new Deputy Fire Chief to us?
Good evening, everybody. I need to get a podium usage here, and now we're going to a seat, but I'll try to...
You're going to wrinkle the dress blues there.
Adjust over. I think I'd like to do a... thank you very much for having me. First off, I appreciate it in this busy day. If I could take a moment and start a little introduction for our new Deputy Chief for Hopkinton before I call him up. Bill has spent 25 years in public service. He's been a firefighter in Oxford, Southbridge, and now Hopkinton. He truly has he started his time as a call firefighter in 1986. He worked a call career through 1994, and then he became a career firefighter in 1994, joined Hopkinton in 2000, was promoted to a officer's position in 2004. He's been a outstanding company officer for the town of Hopkinton all the way through the last month. He has a career working for the Mass Fire Academy as an instructor. And all these pieces is about public service, giving back, influencing others, and I'm just really proud of his history. Just touching on his credentials, he's a certified firefighter 1-2, an advanced EMT. He does CPR instruction for us in Hopkinton. He's a fire instructor 1-2. He's a fire officer 1-2-3-4, which gets him all the way up to chief officer level. He's an incident safety officer. We tie that in with experience. EMS coordinator in the town of Hopkinton, shift lieutenant, training officer. He assisted me in the dispatch program developing the training curriculum for the dispatchers and has helped me implement it since then. Last year, he took the marathon operations role for me as a new chief and made it so that it was much easier for me carrying the burden. He works with the ICS system training town employees and our school people to maintain the level of readiness that we need. And he's assisted in fire inspections in our time of need. Now I talk about the credibility that I look for in somebody to be our deputy chief. Bill has consistently demonstrated pride, honor, and integrity, which I talk about with you in all my appointments for the town. He completed a chief fire officer assessment center that was truly designed for a fire chief level with a really high quality rating in the assessment. He's had a skill set and demeanor that I can depend on for the community and for our organization going forward. And then finally, it's probably my biggest thing for credibility, is he does the little things. He makes sure that a tour is done properly at the fire station. He makes sure a birthday party gets taken for care of at a community. He looks out and makes sure he's giving back, and he makes sure that he's setting an example for his group and others to give back. And I'm just proud to present Bill to you tonight. If I could just ask him to come up. So our final piece is we have a little traditional piece where Bill's a deputy chief already, but we have a ceremony where we bring somebody, we invite them to bring somebody special in their life, go ahead and do our ceremonial pinning. So if I could go ahead and invite Chrissy up. All right, pressure's on now.
All right, it is.
No injuries here, both ambulances are out. Nice. Welcome. Nice job. You get to say a couple words at least. You don't.
There's two hot seats there, Chief.
There's two hot seats, Chief. First of all, Chief, thank you very much. Board of Selectmen, thank you. Mr. Manager, thank you very much for this opportunity. Thank you for giving me the time, over the years to be able to prove myself to the town, the organization, my dedication to the department, dedication to the town of Hopkinton, to the people here. Again, Chief, thank you very much for this. This is an unbelievable dream, I guess is the best way to put it, because it's something I've strived for many, many years. You know, I am a fourth generation fireman, right from my great grandfather to my dad, to my cousin, to me. So this is something that's been in my family for a long time. So again, I want to thank everybody, and I promise I won't let you down. Thank you.
Thank you very much.
Thank you.
That was an amazing list of credentials the chief gave, and an amazing ringing endorsement. I imagine you're blushing.
I am, just a little bit.
And we're so proud to have you, and want to give you our sincerest congratulations.
Thank you, ma'am.
We're a lucky community.
Thank you.
Well, Depp.
Yes, sir.
A little odd to be calling you Depp.
I'm
used to calling you LT. Congratulations.
Thank you.
It's definitely, you've earned it. You thank the chief for giving you the opportunity. You earned the opportunity.
Thank you.
I can't believe you've been here for 16 years. You're still, to me, one of the new guys.
I know, huh?
You're the right man for the job. You're all business all the time. You're personable, you're approachable, professional, and we're lucky to have you as a deputy. So congratulations. Continue on your great work. I don't have any questions that you will. So congratulations.
Thank you very much.
From the bottom of my heart.
Thank you, sir.
And I'll just concur with my other two selectmen. Yeah, I see an action coming into pond sometimes, and I wish I hadn't, but I do. You know, I'm just glad to see Chief Slayman starting to put the stamp on his department. Now he's building in his image, which is what we wanted to see him do and grow. And you're his first big officer hire, and it's a great choice. Great choice. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much. Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you very much.
Want to do any pictures or anything? Okay, we're skipping over the.
Oh, this is like.
Yeah, we're going to the consent agenda. We really only have one thing for one, which is the REMAX Executive Charitable Foundation Neighbors Helping Neighbors 5K Walk Run. And number two, we'll consider approving a $2,000 marathon fund request to help pay for the exercise programs at the Senior Center. Does anyone want to pull out one or two of those, or do you want to
good with
so chair will look for a motion to approve the consent agenda?
So moved. Yes,
just a question to ask on the marathon one. I know the fire chief had some questions about their language. It spoke of the right to exclusively control the race areas, and he was concerned that they have adequate meetings with the BAA and be comfortable that their safety needs were met. The chief is not here. He had asked that be conditioned to perhaps either issue the permit based on it being executed to the satisfaction of our fire department, or else wait until they had their meetings with the BAA.
So do you want to say we'll just break the two of them out?
I think maybe we should.
Okay.
Now that's still
right
here.
Okay. Well, in that case, maybe we can get the chief back in here. So in the meantime, want to discuss the marathon fund request, or do you want to just approve it as it is, considering that the exercise programs at the Senior Center are approved regularly each year for different amounts? This looks like it's going to cover a larger portion of it. So I'll look for a motion to approve $2,000 for the marathon fund request.
So moved.
Second.
Okay, any further discussion? All those in favor? Aye.
Aye.
Opposed? Abstain? Okay, motion carries. Okay, now let's get back into the Neighbors Helping Neighbors 5K Walk Run. Let me get back to your spot that you're talking about it. Yes.
We also received a comment after we had sent the packet out from our insurance agent, suggesting that should the board be inclined to approve this request, pilot permit request, that there be a condition that they provide the actual copy of their insurance naming the town as the additionally insured. The reason being, this request came early to the town, and normally the insurance does not provide such a record if it's over 30 days out.
Okay. Well, it's November 19th. Well, will there be time for to get any of this information before our next meeting? Or do you want to approve it?
My suggestion is if the board is inclined to approve the pilot permit request, that there be a condition that this approval is subject to the applicant providing a copy of their insurance naming the town as the additional insured.
Okay.
Prior to the event.
Okay, and then what about your comments on the police chief? I'm on the fire chief. I didn't find that in my packet.
Wait a minute. No, I think Mr. Kamalo is referring to the neighbors be helping neighbors run on November 19, correct?
Yes.
And I'm referring to the Boston Marathon.
No, we're not discussing that one. They're not here today. That's why I said we weren't bringing that one up.
Okay, so we're only doing.
We're only doing two and three. That's why I missed my first set.
Okay, I'm sorry, I misunderstood.
Oh, okay. So there's so you have nothing on two other than the provide insurance then.
Right. I don't have anything on that except Mr. Kamalo's recommendation, which we should add.
Mr. Tedstone.
No, I'm good.
Excellent. Okay, so the chair will entertain a motion to approve the REMAX Executive Charitable Foundation Neighbors Helping Neighbors 5K run with the provision that they provide the necessary insurance naming the town.
So moved.
Second.
Okay, any further discussion? All those in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Opposed? Abstained? Motion carries. Okay. 7:30. Okay, I think we're good enough for that one. Are we close enough to 7:30 to open the public hearing at 7:27?
We're 7:29,
okay. So is there anything else we can discuss? No, we really have nothing else. Okay, how about liaison assignments? Anybody do anything this week?
No, I'm meeting with the elementary school building committee tomorrow.
Excellent.
Okay. I do not have anything.
Okay.
About a minute.
Future board agenda items?
Not really.
And the hour being 7:30.
Okay.
Excellent. Okay. I'd like to open the public hearing for a grant location, Eversource Energy in Wood Street. The Board of Selectmen will consider a petition and planned by the NSTAR Electric Company, otherwise known as Eversource Energy, for the purpose of obtaining a grant of location to install approximately 45 feet of conduit within Wood Street. The work is necessary to provide electric service to a new DPW building. Okay, we have the proponent already in place. Excellent. So we could have done it at 7:29. You were sitting right there. Excellent. Thank you very much. Okay, could you please introduce yourself and.
Sure. My name is Christine Crosby. I'm with Eversource Energy, and we are requesting a grant of location for approximately 45 feet of conduit at pole 30 over 30 Wood Street, and that would be to provide the new electric service to the new DPW building.
Okay. Everything seems in order. Anything that you have to?
Yeah, I do have one question, because I know we spoke with you just at the previous meeting about a similar request, which was going on to Franklin Road, and you were going to do directional drilling on that one because it had been recently repaved. What is the situation with Wood Street? Is that going to be needed, or are they going to be tearing up the pavement for their construction anyway? It doesn't matter.
It wasn't, we didn't get any kind of recommendation from the DPW director as far as going with directional drilling, but if that's something that you can, you want me to discuss with him, I can do that. Normally, it's, this would be a normal, like, open trench.
Yeah.
Cut.
I didn't have time to go down to Wood Street to see the condition of the pavement. I understand they do that, what, primarily to save the pavement from being torn up?
If yes.
It's been recently done.
Yeah, I'm surprised Mr. Westling's not here.
I am too. He said he was coming.
Do we know if the poles are on the proximal or distal side of the road to the DPW?
On the opposite side of the street, is that what you mean? Yeah.
We'll have to.
Yeah, we have to cut across the street.
I'm not sure of the pavement there either.
I don't know.
It seems smooth.
No, they just re-hot-topped it last
year,
didn't they?
Yeah, that's what I thought. Yeah.
Eric?
Because they just recently paved.
Yeah.
Yeah, so if you could look into directional drilling just to save it. Because no matter how well somebody fixes that stuff, it always ends up having a big divot. Mm-hmm. And to be in front of that new $16 million DPW facility, I want it to look good.
I mean, on one hand, with all the construction that's going to be going on, maybe the pavement's going to take a hit. Here comes Mr. Westling right now.
Excellent.
The pavement shouldn't take
Mr. Westling.
It's used to
perfect timing.
Good evening.
If you could jump into a hot seat for a second, we had a couple questions.
Easy question.
Sure.
Feel free.
We were just discussing Eversource's request for the 45 feet of conduit, and we just wanted to ask you if they needed to use directional drilling to save the pavement. What's the condition of that pavement there? Has it been recently redone, or?
If I may, Mr. Chairman, I thought you were going to ask if the utility pole was installed at Fruit Street yet.
No, we'll get that. We know that this is important to you, so we'll.
So if this is in the section that was recently paved by the town on Franklin Road, then we would request.
No, we're talking about
this is the Wood
Street. This is DPW facility.
I'm terribly sorry.
But you just asked for that on Franklin Road.
But we'll get back to that
one
in a second.
Yes. Do you want on Wood Street too?
Thank you for clarifying. Sorry, stepping in cold. So on Wood Street, we don't see the need for directional drilling because the town's contract will be excavating across the road for water, sewer, and gas utilities. So there will be a patch that we will construct of better condition in that section.
And you'll make sure that it's as good as the road is right now?
Absolutely. Better than new, with a beautiful new building next to it.
Excellent. Okay, so then. I guess we have
that was my that only question.
We can drop that requirement. Okay, but now if you could update us on the other one, on the.
Are we done with the?
Yeah,
we, with Eversource here.
Well, no, but actually, didn't this have something to do with Eversource? Weren't we holding them up on some poles, and could we get an update maybe?
Yes, specifically at two issues. John, if you could speak to whether the pole has been installed at Fruit Street. And secondly, also update the board on the conversations between Eversource and the asphalt company regarding paving on Front and Clinton.
Be happy to. Through you, Mr. Chairman. As of today, the pole has not yet been installed at Fruit Street. So I just sent off an email of panic to John Daly of Eversource asking if they could please ensure that gets put in tomorrow. That's a critical path item for us. Without that, our operational move to Fruit Street won't be able to occur on time. Secondly, the contractor who does the town's rubber chip has been in conversations with Eversource and provided Eversource with a contract amount for putting in a new rubber chip for that section that was torn up 2 years ago between Clinton Street and El Perla Farms Road. It will be curb to curb, it will be a new rubber chip, and Eversource will be cutting a check to that contractor and asking them to schedule them for next year. So I'm confident that that work will be completed next year.
Is the road in good enough condition now for winter maintenance?
Through you, Mr. Chairman, it has held up very well.
Great. Okay. You satisfied with this one?
I am satisfied.
So the chair will entertain a motion to for the grant of location for the 45 feet of conduit within Wood Street.
So moved.
Second.
Any further discussion? All those in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Opposed? Abstained. Motion carries. Thank you very much. Thanks for your time.
Thank you.
Thanks, John. Okay, now we'd like to schedule a hearing for the addendum to the Hopkinton Center of the Arts. I'd like to consider October 4th, 2016, to review an addendum to the lease agreement between the Town of Hopkinton and Hopkinton Center of the Arts and the Hopkinton Community Endowment for the lease of real property located at 98 Hayden Row. This is a two-year amendment clarifying the independent events, rentals, and sale or distribution of alcohol at the facility. So Chair will entertain a motion to schedule a hearing for October 4th.
So moved.
Second.
Any further discussion?
We have someone here from the Center of the Arts. Did they want to talk about any of this?
Well, this is just to schedule the hearing. We don't really need anything. Okay, all those in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Opposed? Abstained? Okay, motion carries. So we'll have a public hearing October 4th, and we'll discuss that. Okay, so we're a little bit ahead of schedule, which is always a good thing.
Yes. Ask Mr. Kamalo, that public hearing, what abutters will be notified, because it is an interest beyond just the immediate neighborhood? Will you do the 300 yard? What's the range of abutter notification we're going to use?
In fact, we will have both a targeted public notice as well as a general notice,
right,
that will be posted on the town website. The targeted notice will focus on the 300-foot buffer that we normally use for alcohol licenses.
So when you say targeted notice, there will be notices sent to those abutters within that range?
Yes.
Okay. Thank you.
Well, basically, all we were doing was setting the date, because there's really nothing we can discuss now, because we don't have the information in front of us at this time.
Not on the substance of it, but just on whether.
Please come to the microphone.
Well, come on.
Thank you, Chair.
Sure.
Again, Kurt Fleegoff, I'm co-chair of the HCA board. And we're happy to have neighborhood input. We already had that once when we came in for an alcohol license in the spring, and there wasn't much in the way of opposition there. But I do want to just clarify that what we're asking for is an addendum to a lease with respect to the use of the HCA. We are not applying, we are not applying for a liquor license.
Right.
So, and I think that the addendum, or I'm sorry, the agenda would suggest to the public that we are seeking a liquor license. And ordinarily, a hearing of the sort that you're contemplating would be held only if there was an application for a liquor license. So I do just want to state for the record that this is highly unusual, and that ordinarily there would not be the type of notice that you are calling for here. Again, we're happy to talk to neighbors, we're happy to have people in, and I assume that when this hearing does occur, because it's apparent that it's going to, that everyone who shows up will have an opportunity to be heard. Mm-hmm. And have an opportunity to express their views, not just people that, you know, may have some reservations about it.
Absolutely. Yeah, and could you make sure that's noted, that it is just an addendum, it is not an application for a liquor license then?
We will clarify that in both the notice as well as the agenda announcing the meeting.
Thank you. I appreciate the opportunity.
Thank you very much. Thanks for coming. Okay. Is great. 20 minutes ahead. Okay, now we're going to discuss the water restrictions and the drought situational update. The board will receive a report from the Director of Public Works, Water and Sewer, and manager regarding the drought and water restrictions in the town. So, Mr. Westling, Mr. Carty, and the Board of Health, if you wish to give any input, feel free. Okay. Good evening.
Mr. Chairman, good evening. Eric and I are here this evening to give the board an update on the status of the water ban that we have and the drought situation and the steps that we've taken and where we go from here.
Thank you. I apologize in advance, a little bit under the weather, so maybe a little coughing in between, so I do apologize. As I'd like to start our most of our notices, as we said out to the public, water is our most precious resource. And unfortunately, sometimes it takes situations we're in now for that to really hit home. You know, 364 days a year, usually we turn the tap on, it's always there. It's the only when we have that water main break occasionally and route it for 3 or 4 hours, we really see the inconvenience it causes. So, you know, right now I think we're in a situation where we've had really over 2 years of below normal rainfall. We're almost 20 plus inches in our area below the normal for what we normally receive, which is a significant amount. Currently 53% of the state is in severe drought during the latest update of the drought monitors, which is again a significant amount. And I think anybody can see just by looking, if you look at the what's now the ice house puddle, you can basically walk across it, and the only other time I've seen that in my lifetime is when they intentionally drained it. You know, the conditions are real that are out there. Just if I could, just another some more the statistical things we're at. For instance, we measure the groundwater levels around our well fields. Back in April, those levels were right around the 9-foot mark, meaning from the base of the ground to where you hit water was 9 feet. Currently, we're at about 13.5 feet to that, so almost 4.5 feet. Those have dropped over near the well fields. For rain, I'm probably the only person that likes it when they're on vacation when it rains, because it makes my job easier. But this year just has not produced. You know, yesterday we're expecting inches plus. They kept promising that, and we got a measly 0.22 inches of rain. It just seems to get to Hopkinton, watch it on the radar, it'll split around us or fizzle out before it gets here. So we, unfortunately, we're not getting that relief that we need. A little bit helps, you know, definitely, but we need some more. I mean, April we had 3 inches of rain, and almost every month after that has gone down, and we've only had about 1 inch in most of the other months. New England has always been thought of as water rich. We've always been lucky to have what's been plentiful water around here, and I think that attitude has to change. And you know, we say it every year when we do our promotions for, you know, we're forced by the state to put on mandatory restrictions, and we try to let people know, you know, the reasons for that. It's situations like this, we never know when they're going to happen, and we're at a point now where, you know, it is community-wide. As Martha stated, this is a community situation, whether it's town water, well water. It's a tough situation, and it's going to take everybody's part in order for us to get through this and make it out to the other side. You know, we've been very lucky that we haven't had any major water breaks through this, which is, you know, we've gone a significant amount of time without having one, which is, knock on wood, kind of uncanny for us, and we haven't had any major fires. You know, when the fire chief calls me at 2 a.m, I know it's not good, but thankfully it hasn't been anything severe yet, so we've been lucky in that aspect as well. And just again, going back to that water rich thing, there's a kind of industry saying that we're in the mode of set it and forget it, meaning mostly pertaining to lawn sprinklers. Beginning of the year, people turn them on, whether it's raining out, whether we had 2 inches of rain the day before, they're coming on the next day, and we really have to break that habit. We have to be conscious, hands-on with our with our water use, because going into the future, you know, we have more people moving into town, town is growing, and it's going to take everyone's concerted effort in order for us to sustain our water system going forward. So, and we, you know, in our educational pieces, we write every spring and summer, I put those pieces out there that, you know, if you get an inch of rain, that's all your lawn needs for the week. So if you get a rain, it's very simple to step outside. A lot of stuff is, you know, you can do it by your phone now. Just turn that valve off, and there's no need for it to run the rest of the week. And that's what we're going to have everybody be conscious of going forward. And we say it over and over and over, but I think it really hits home now with the situation that we're in. What we have done, we've had, we've called for a couple meetings of the emergency management group to discuss the issues. Myself and, I want to say Lieutenant Miller, but now it's Deputy Chief Miller, sat in on a conference call with MEMA to discuss the situation about 3 weeks ago. And the state gave us their take. The state was taking it serious at that time. They have really lined up a lot of emergency supplies in terms of trying to get tankers available, bottled water available, you know, reaching out to other parts of the country right now that don't have the issue in case of the dire, you know, emergencies for everyone. Unfortunately, you know, if there's a, during most summers, if there's a problem and you're able to, if you have a managed well go down, you're able to rely on your neighbor to help get you through. But this situation, everybody around is in the same boat, so it's, we can't reach out. We're not adjacent to a MWA community where we can tap into, so we don't have that luxury. We've been working closely with the Ashland officials. They've asked us to cut back our usage about 100,000 gallons a day, which we are complying with to help them do that. We are implementing our drought procedures. Actually spoke with our largest users, who are EMC Dell LNG plant, informed them, and they were well aware of the situation, but formally informed them that we were looking for any and all ways for them to help with their consumption of water to help us out, and they were very amenable to that, realizing the situation, you know, any unnecessary trainings or anything at all they could do, so they were going to work on that with their staff and management. We've been out ramping up enforcement. We've been going out all different hours, making sure people are complying with it. And really, at this point, it just comes down to, you know, this, you cannot value a green lawn over not having water come out of the tap. I mean, grass is, well, I should say lawns are man-made. They weren't meant to be short and green. They're meant to be 3 feet tall and brown. That's how they survived drought. We're trying to fight Mother Nature. We can't fight Mother Nature. So it's really incumbent on everybody. At this point, if you're, you know, you're watering your lawn, you are doing a disservice to the entire community at this point. So we ask for everyone's compliance during the situation. We've been putting the message board out in all areas of town. There are certain areas of town that have more of the automatic sprinklers than others. We try to target those areas because that's really the largest use of that. We've been sending out the additional messages. And we've also been readying our Pond Street wells, which we will most likely have to activate if we continue in this vein. Although the water quality is not the greatest, it's high in iron, which is not a health risk, but it's a nuisance, so that will cause discoloration of the water, but we do have that as our backup option as well. So we're getting those wells ready to run in case they are needed. And then we continue to ask people to, as we do in all of our notices, to please follow us to get the information when we're trying to get it out there. We're, every time we send out a message, you know, we send it out on our Twitter, on the webpage, HCAM, Hop News, WMRC Radio. We really try to get it broad-based, you know, the reverse 911 calls that the chief has helped out with to get the information out there so that people are aware of it. So, you know, we, again, I think it was a great article in the Metro West this Sunday that, you know, people, I think, really just need to take that to heart of the situation we're in so that we can get through this.
Thank you. Ms. Wright, any questions?
What are the consequences right now for people that are violating the ban?
The town bylaw calls for a first offense as a warning. Second offense is a $100 fine. A third offense is either an additional $100 fine or the termination of water service.
Mr. Kamalo, I assume if that's a bylaw, the only way that can be amended or changed or added to would be through a town meeting. We can't make an emergency change in those consequences.
Through the chair, John, can you please clarify whether the fines are spelled out in the departmental regulations or in a town bylaw? Because the processes will be different depending on where the bylaw is.
Mm-hmm. Excuse us one moment.
That's fine.
Because if I might ask, this resident who spoke earlier, I can't recall your name, Martha, I think, she did speak about increasing consequences and increasing the fines. And, you know, it just seems to me in this day and age, certainly for some of the homes where they're probably doing a lot of the watering, a $100 fine may not carry the weight that it should. And these are rather serious times.
Through you, Mr. Chairman, the penalties are laid out in the town bylaws, not the rules and regulations of the Department of Public Works.
Okay, so that's town meeting then.
Can we amend those? As an emergency basis?
I believe the answer would be no if they were established at town meeting. Right. Unless if the actual bylaw has a provision that allows the selectmen to adjust the fines.
Okay. Then I have a follow-on question. Those are the penalties that are on the books. What is actually happening when there's a violation? Are there bills being sent out to these people now? Are they getting a knock on the door or an orange flyer? Are these actually being imposed?
Yes, we have imposed, we've roughly around a dozen so far, and they go out on the next water bill for that section.
And through you, Mr. Chair, are those warnings or are these, there's only been a dozen penalties, and are those a combination of warnings and actual monetary fines?
The dozen was an actual fines.
So those homeowners are in danger of the next step, which would be the option of, it was either termination of the service or what was the other part?
Or another $100 fine.
And that is, which option you choose is at the discretion of the water department?
It's in the rules and regulations. Yeah, it doesn't really state. It states that one or the other.
It can't be more than 100. It's 100 or terminate service.
Correct. That's the way it's written in the.
Again, Mr. Chair, what would happen if the service were terminated? Does it say that it's for a day, a week? How would that I suspect it's never been done before.
Correct.
How would this happen? Because I think there's a concern. There's certainly a concern on some of the residents that these are serious times, and this can't just be blown off. Nothing to get the message stronger than having your water not come out of the tap. How would we do that termination?
Through the chair, I think that we would look long and hard at the options. I think that I would tend to lean towards another $100 fine. Those could just continue to accumulate. We would hate to get to a situation where we were turning off someone's water who may have situations inside the home where water is important to their mm-hmm. daily needs. Mm-hmm. But we would certainly evaluate those on a case-by-case basis.
So, to your point, I question how important the water would be to their household if after the warning and first fine, they snubbed their nose at you and said, you know, I live at whatever, and my lawn is worth more than $100, find me the $100. And then you say, okay, so here we are, we're at this point now where we're able to shut your water off. And then they come and say, well, I have a 3-month-old baby. You should have thought of that before you continued to water. Another question I have is, if you find, say, one property owner non-compliant, what's the frequency of revisiting that person? If I got a $100 fine today, or not me, but if someone else got a $100 fine today, and then if they, if you weren't gonna come back for 2 weeks and they kept the sprinklers on for 2 weeks, but could you come back at noon and could come back at 5 and wind up finding them 3 times during the day? At that point, after the third fine, I would say, you know what? This water thing for you is just not working out. It's time for it to go away for a bit.
Through the chair, we haven't had any repeat violators where we've had to find them and then found them to be in violation the second time. Mm-hmm. We do know those locations where the folks are violating. We are looking at them again, but we haven't had that chance to catch them on a second violation.
Neighbors are real good at letting us know.
Yeah.
Well, it's important because in California, they've been dealing with this for several years. And there's actually a brown lawn pride that actually having a brown lawn it's a sense of community because we're all in it together. Now, I always had a competition with my brother who had the best lawn, and I had to surrender this year because I never had a sprinkler system anyway, so I'm one of the few in my neighborhood that doesn't have one. But I really think it's important the enforcement really is important, because the people that are snubbing their nose have to understand that we're all in this together. The one thing that was brought up earlier by Martha is, do we have jurisdiction over private wells?
That's a great question. Mr. Chairman, through the Department of Public Works, we do not have jurisdiction.
Okay. So that's something that's...
So Eric, this is kind of your Blizzard of 78 right now.
Yes.
In the water world.
Yeah. If I could, Mr. Chairman, to just one thing I'd like to know, as part of our emergency management meetings, we get a lot of phone calls, whether it's well water or town water. We get a lot of private well ones. Cognizant of that, we spoke in our last emergency management meeting, even talking about the town facilities that have town wells and the perception, you know, of those running during that. So there was some reach out, you know, to let, you know, for instance, the town common and some of the other areas that, you know, this really has got to come. There's a whole everyone's in type of effort to make sure that we're all in.
Yeah, because we just have to have everybody understand that, you know, hill of pride. We've got to, we're all in it together. And whether it's your own private well, your own private pond, it's, you know, unless it's growing to live.
On the subject of private wells, I understand that we don't have any jurisdiction, so probably you folks are not monitoring the areas that are not on town water, but I don't know if you get calls or complaints from other people about someone that's watering and you say it's on a private well. You know, this resident earlier spoke about communication, and perhaps for those that are using private wells that are still watering, it wouldn't hurt to have some kind of a public information sheet made up for them that explained how aquifers work and how even if you're on a public well, it affects everyone in town and could be left at the door or in the mailbox or delivered to that homeowner, just to kind of give them a word and a polite explanation for why, even though it's their water, it's still everybody's water. I just think we could do more with communicating to those people instead of, you know, this point just saying, well, nothing we can do about it, it's too bad. Maybe we could do a little communication outreach.
It's an excellent point. And when we had the emergency managers group meeting, an email was sent to Jay Gulfey, the director of Parks and Recreation, asking them to consider turning off the watering of the Common and the Fruit Street fields. And they did have a vote Monday night. I don't know how that vote went.
They voted to shut them off till further notice.
Excellent. And it, one of the things I wanted to highlight is that we are taking all preparations that we have available to us for the next steps should the drought continue, which all forecasts show that it will continue. As Eric stated, we are readying wells 4 and 5. He did state that those are high in iron, which is not an indication of poor water quality, but it is an aesthetic water quality concern. So when those wells do get turned on, folks may notice the staining or browning of their laundry. Those type of things may begin to occur, but I just want to reinforce the fact that those are not water quality violations from a Department of Environmental Protection or from a public health perspective.
Are those the ones we're going to add the blenders to?
Yes, sir. The sand filters. Mm-hmm.
And they will make your lawn brown, so you want to turn your sprinklers on.
Does the town have any responsibility if a homeowner on a well runs out of water? Is there any responsibility to the town? Like, can they come to us and say, we're on town well? I mean, we're on a well, we're not on town water, but it's dry.
We are happy, through you, Mr. Chairman, we are happy to connect them to the town's water system if there is town water infrastructure in front of their property. Beyond that, I believe it would fall upon the Board of Health because they govern private wells.
Okay.
To help find a solution, whether it's digging a deeper well,
yeah.
sure that there are many other options that are available to folks whose wells run dry.
And that's where I think the documentation would come in handy if you're getting calls from neighbors saying that they're, say, 25,000 Granite Street is running their well 24 hours a day to irrigate their lawn, and then they come to you 2 weeks later and say, my well's dry, and I don't have any water for the house. You know, you could say, well, you know, we did observe on this date that your water, you know, your sprinklers were running, and they were running at, you know, we were called by four neighbors letting us know that they run 24 hours a day, and I was just wondering if there's any repercussion to the town if someone's individual, personally owned well runs dry. But you answered that.
Well, you know what I think. You know, in the when we were talking before about media and getting the word out there, you know, putting the list of names of people that got fines.
Public shaming.
You know, if that's just one of the things. If you want to have a green lawn, Norman's covering up his eyes on this one.
No.
If you want to have a green lawn, well, then you're going to wear another badge. You know, or do we have awards for the brownest lawn? You know what I mean? That's, you know, we've got to look at all of these ways of publicizing it. You know, it's, you know, if the DPW can, at the same time that you're out there looking for the green lawns and the puddles to give out the fines, if you could note some of the brownest lawns and say, this poor guy, you know, and then let's publicize, let's have a contest. I know it sounds crazy, but, you know, these are strange times.
Through you, Mr. Chairman, that it's important for those folks that are on private wells to understand that their aquifers work the same way that the town's wells aquifers work, where the groundwater is at a certain level and it's lowering every day that we go without rain. If they pump those wells to water their lawn, they are also lowering their aquifers. So they're putting their own wells in danger and the neighbor's wells in danger. So it really is a town-wide issue for everyone, whether they're on public water or private wells.
So would it be possible for you? Sorry, if I would it be possible for you to do a small white paper or something that could be published in Hop News and the Independent and some of the others, explaining this to people, because some people may not understand that the tide rises all boats and the aquifer is lower with every watering of the lawn.
It's a great idea, and I'd be happy to.
To that point, Mr. Coutinho, what I was going to say is, I think there should be a very prominent public notice put out to private well owners explaining that the water ban really applies to you as well. When you pull up the town website, there's all the information about the water ban. I think that would be a good place to add a public notice to private well owners. And, you know, we can't impose fines on them, but then official notification or explanation that the aquifer and the water table relates to every homeowner, and how private well owners are expected to exercise the same care.
Excellent point. Through you, Mr. Chairman, be happy to work with Edward Tannen from the Board of Health, since private wells do fall under the Board of Health's jurisdiction, and also to put a broader notice on the webpage that would apply to everyone who uses water.
If I could, through you, Mr. Chairman, we do that in all of our notices. We say, even though this is not subject to the town system, if you have a private well, you should use it judiciously because you're not immune. It's a very good article in the Metro West paper. If anyone got a chance to read it, really explained, you know, Hopkinton, home of the Hillers, back when we grew up, the stone throwers, stone throwers for a reason, a lot of bedrock, and those are very susceptible to going dry a lot easier and a lot quicker. I know we have areas in town that there's some very deep wells in order to try to hit the water. So it's even more critical in our town because of the geography and the hydraulic underflows.
And the fact that we're the highest point in the Middlesex County. Stuff runs downhill, right?
Is this right?
Right, what that's it.
I would just add one more thing that, you know, hopefully we'll get out of this soon, but Mr. Carty has said that this has actually been about a 2-year pattern low water, and maybe this board would want to consider for the next town meeting re-examining those bylaws and perhaps strengthening the fine structure or allowing more leeway or somehow allowing us going forward to be able to come down a little harder.
I like that.
If this continues next year.
Mm. Well, Silicon Society last week was asking when we look at the rate studies, to look at a two-tier summer and summer and winter.
John. In fact,
sorry.
Yeah, through the chair, I think first off, I want to thank Martha for your comments. They are very well received. And at the same time, also acknowledge the excellent work done by town residents in responding to the earlier guidance from the water department in undertaking conservation measures. I can share with the board that from my conversations with the DPW director, the measures that the town took and the positive response from the town residents did have a positive effect. And therefore, to that end, respectfully, I'm asking the board to authorize our town staff to work with the board chair to issue a communique to private well owners focusing on education.
Yes.
And I think as John said, simultaneously, and this is outside what I'm requesting the board to act on, simultaneously we'll continue our conversations with the Board of Health to see how we can also work collaboratively with the board to address the issue from a public health concern, public health as well as environmental perspective. Again, I think I simply want to underscore that the response from the residents has been encouraging. We have received email on this issue showing concern as well as ingenuity on the part of residents suggesting solutions. I also wanted to acknowledge the effort taken by the town's fire chief, who is also the emergency management director. He has activated the Hopkinton Emergency Management Group, meeting regularly to decide on actions to be taken. And Steve, great job doing that.
And if I can continue on this positive note, how much have we reduced consumption?
We were upwards of 1.7 million during the real heat in July. After we went to the initial no lawn watering right around August 1st, we were able to see a significant drop down to almost 1.1, you know, relatively within a week, which was, as
That's
the manager
great.
Said, you know, the majority of people are complying. They realize the situation. So it brought us down and was able to keep us sustained to the point we are right now.
So as a board, we'd like to thank everybody that's conserving, and please keep it up because we're all in it together. Thank you very much.
May I just make one final
Absolutely.
Comment? I just wanted to recognize the hard work of Eric and the rest of the water department. When they go out at night, they're going out and then coming back to work a full 8-hour day. So kudos to Eric and the team for their efforts at getting the town ready for the next steps that are required, and also for helping to enforce and educate the public on why it's important to conserve their water.
Great. Thank you very much, Eric.
Hope you feel better.
Thank you.
Yes, thanks for coming in.
Thank you.
Thank you, John. Okay. Okay, we're a few minutes early for the chair of the board of the planning board. The board will review a letter from the planning board chair regarding public safety concerns of the LNG facility on Wilson Street. We'll review a letter from the planning board chair dated August 16th recommending construction of a stone wall or barrier on Wilson Street and to address an unidentified accident potential and installation of gas lights to mitigate vapor cloud. Mr. Chairman, thanks for coming. Could you present your findings for us?
Thank you for having me. My name is Ken Weissmantle. I am chairman of the planning board. I'd like to also offer a little bit of my past experience. I spent 18 years of my career in cryogenics, where I managed hundreds of cryogenic liquefaction plants, including one methane liquefying plant. During the planning board hearings on Legacy Farms Road North, the planning board carefully considered the LNG spill dispersion reports that were commissioned by the Board of Selectmen. The applicant presented a mitigation plan which allows the planning board to find that the additional housing could be built safely with certain conditions. The attachment to my letter shows the thermal exclusion zone and the vapor exclusion zones where no housing will be permitted. The new smaller boundary for the vapor exclusion zone is created by a string of gas lights, which act as, I'll say, a picket, if you go back to, I'll say, Civil War type terminology. And basically, these gas lights would ignite the gas cloud if one ever came and got to those points, and therefore it wouldn't spread into adjacent housing areas. The gaslight proposal effectively limits about one-third of the area around the LNG plant, which is the area that Legacy's new housing is being proposed and has been permitted. In the report, the Smith & Burgess company identified a scenario for a failure of a pipe near Wilson Road. The planning board strongly recommends that a barrier be constructed to limit reduce the possibility that this small possibility could ever happen, given the consequences that would happen if that scenario came through. The gas light proposal does a great job of limiting the vapor exclusion zone. And the planning board voted to send a letter to suggest that the selectmen, who have responsibility for safety in the town, consider adding more gas lights to protect the other two-thirds of the circle around it. The planning board in our jurisdiction could require that as a condition for mitigation to allow development to happen on Legacy Farms, and that's why you have the string of gas lights that are shown in the proposal, or in the attachment. However, we don't have jurisdiction over, I'll say, the non-Legacy Farm aspect. So going, I'll say, southward from the plant, westward, and northward, we don't do a really good job of protecting it, though from the east and, I'll say, southeast, we've got that limited onto open space land that's protected. Just as a word of explanation, the attachment shows some large circles. Those are the thermal exclusion zones. Those are kind of large diameter circles. And then you'll see a series of dots with smaller circles. And that, those are dots are the proposed locations for the gas lights. They're spaced approximately 250 to 400 feet in between them, somewhere in that range. So basically, that's why we're here, is to suggest to you that, one, you build or have Eversource build a better barrier on Wilson Street, and two, seriously study whether or not the gaslight proposal that the planning board found was very effective in protecting the new people that are coming into Legacy Farms would offer protection to, I'll say, some existing homes in Hopkinton. Putting the gas lights in was not that expensive for the applicant for Legacy Farms. And it's several thousands of dollars a year to provide gas to them. I mean, they will burn 24 hours a day as our sentinels to stop that from ever happening.
Excellent. Ms. Wright, do you have any questions for
I just want to ask Mr. Weissmantle on the sketch that I'm looking at. I'm assuming the lights are the blue dots.
Unfortunately, I've got a black and white
they're around the circles. Right.
The dots in between the smaller circles are where each of the gas lights will be installed.
So
and so it's a light green area.
But then over around the tanks, There's a group of six dots.
Oh, okay. Those are the center of the thermal exclusion zone, which is about 1,200 feet, I believe, is recommended by this consultant.
Oh, okay.
And those dots are just where they drew the circles. Probably it would be...
Yeah, that's the center of each circle.
It'd probably be... It's very similar to what is shown there. It's probably not drawn exactly correctly.
This would be the center of the circle. This one's the center of the circle.
Okay, all right.
John, do you know what that is, what that purple dot is right there?
That would probably be the center of the circle.
Okay.
There might be another dot, Brendan, that shows...
Yes, pink.
That is the thermal exclusion zone for the vaporizer that's on the east side of the plant.
That's probably what it is.
What if there was a major accident on that? You would not want to be in those circles, the big circles.
Yeah, I would.
Or even the little
tend to
circles.
Agree with you on that.
Well, if I can comment, and I was, of course, in on most of the planning board meetings earlier on this and listen to the consultants and all and recognize the level of risk or not level of risk, but it seems incumbent upon both Legacy and the town to do what they can to provide protection nonetheless. And from what I heard, the likelihood of the actual release through the tanks, the vapor cloud and all, was less than the likelihood of this guillotine cut of the pipe that goes across the road. I mean, if anybody drives down Wilson Street, those pipes are right there. And there's very little to protect it right now. It's protected by a sort of a chain link fence thing on both sides, and there's on one side a couple of jersey barriers and a pile of gravel and dirt on one side, and the other one has really nothing except chain link and a metal guardrail. So, you know, and this is a hazard that's now been officially identified in some of these surveys, so it seems that once it's been called out, it would be incumbent upon us to find some way to provide more protection, whether that's our doing it or the gas company doing it. It is in the public way, and you know, I think we should explore how we can get this done. It's probably short money to build a wall or a barrier, and it's a risk that really we all should be protected from townwide, as well as the people that'd be living up there.
You have anything, Mr. Tedstone?
Nope, nothing.
So with that, the chair will entertain a motion to direct the staff and town council to take appropriate actions as outlined in the planning board chair's letter.
So moved.
Second.
Any further discussion? All those in favor? Oh, okay, sure.
I was got something. Well, I think there's two pieces of this. There's the wall and there's the gas lights. And where those gas lights, additional gas lights, are located, how necessary they are. I don't know whether that's. I definitely see the
well.
Need
actually,
for the wall.
Well, he's also saying that it should go through the engineers and all that to make sure that they are placed appropriately. And the same thing with the stanchions in the wall. We want to make sure that that's designed appropriately also.
Right. I'm just.
And we need some civil engineers and some PEs to weigh in on that.
Okay.
Mr. Chairman?
Yes.
Without the gas lights, you're looking at a minimum of 3,700 feet from the tanks. That was testimony by the former fire chief in sworn testimony to the DPU on that. If you look at Smith and Burgess's, it was significantly more than that. I think there was enough peer review that their worst case scenario is probably not at all
big.
Proper, right. but you're still looking at a significant distance from the plant, and there are existing homes in that 3,700.
And we'll have another bite at the apple when we see the costs and all that too. So we have a motion and a second. Any further discussion?
Nope.
All those in favor? Aye.
Aye.
Opposed? Abstained? Motion carries.
Thank you very much.
Okay. So I should be going through this one, but I have all the other things open there. Goal setting, we're going to skip that because we have two members missing.
Oh, yeah, that's right.
We did liaison assignments, so we look at the board invites. Okay, town manager's report. Mr. Kamalo.
Through the chair, I am respectfully requesting the board approve the modification of the budget schedule as outlined in the memo that I included in your meeting packet, as well as the handout that I just shared with the board that modifies the capital process. And why I'm making this request. Under the current charter, the town manager can make a recommendation to the Board of Selectmen to modify the schedule, so long as the selectmen as well as the appropriation committee approve that request. I am not asking for a permanent change in the schedule. I'm simply making this request in the context of the FY18 budget process. Secondly, I am also making this request as a way of improving the quality of our service relative to the information that we provide to town residents for town meeting. Under the proposed schedule, the budget process will commence earlier. Specifically, instead of commencing on November 1st, we will kick off the process October 4th. You'll notice in the handout as well as the information included in the packet, on the left-hand side is the column that identifies the charter deadline, and the next column is the new deadline that I'm proposing. In terms of when the process will complete, we are suggesting that the process completes at the end of March. Under the current process, I have seen our hardworking volunteers working on the budget a few minutes before town meeting. I also believe that with the proposed schedule in place, we will have the opportunity to allow for a much more robust process for engaging and giving quality information to town residents well in advance of town meeting. And also, under the proposed schedule, we have made an attempt to line up the operating budget schedule with the capital planning process, as well as the CPC process. The specific deadlines are as follows. Under the charter, October 1st, the town manager establishes the budget schedule. We are suggesting September 28th. November 1st, under the charter, the selectmen issue a policy statement establishing the general budget guidelines. We are suggesting October 4th, and we've also provided some detail where a day after that, the finance director then distributes the budget materials to the town departments, boards, and committees. Under the charter, the departmental budgets on the town side are due January 1st. We're suggesting that the submissions be a month earlier, with December 1st as the deadline. We are suggesting that the school budget, instead of coming in February 1st, that it comes in 3 weeks earlier, January 6th. We are also suggesting that the town manager submit the draft budget January 17th instead of March 1st. And the reason here is to give the selectmen adequate time to review the budget before forwarding it to the Appropriations Committee. We have also in the past tried different ways of scheduling department heads before the selectmen. We are identifying a minimum of two opportunities to do that under this scenario, February 7th and February 21st, as the dates when departments come before the selectmen. We're recommending that the selectmen submit the budget to the Appropriations Committee on February 21st. Under the charter, the selectmen are scheduled to do so March 15th. And we have the Appropriations Committee process completing its, completing its budget hearings March 31st. In the past months, this has been done, rather in the past years, this has been done usually a couple weeks before town meeting. And then regarding the capital process and the information that I just shared with you via the handout reflects the discussion that the CFO and myself had with the combined Capital Improvement Committee and the Appropriations Committee meeting. We are suggesting that the Finance Director distribute the capital materials October 5th, that the town school departments submit their 10-year capital plans to the CIC November 1st. Similarly, that all submissions to CPC complete by November 1st. Let me highlight, we are offering November 1st as a guideline. However, we are encouraging departments to begin approaching CPC as well as CIC as early as possible. And then January 17th, the town manager submits the capital plan to the selectmen and the appropriations committee as part of the town manager's submission of the comprehensive budget. So as I said earlier, this is now an opportunity to line up the capital planning process with the operating budget process. And the selectmen were also suggesting that when the departments appear before the selectmen to discuss their operating budget, that they also be ready to discuss their capital article requests. And we're hoping that the Appropriations Committee will also complete its review of the capital projects by March 31st. In terms of process, let me share with the board that the CFO and myself did meet with the school superintendent, Dr. McLeod, as well as the business manager, Ralph Dumas. They gave us their feedback on the schedule. We made the necessary adjustments that they pointed out with the understanding that this coming Thursday, the school committee will review this proposed schedule and give and provide their feedback. We also met yesterday, as I said, with the CIC as well as the Appropriations Committee. The CIC voted in favor of the proposed schedule. The Appropriations Committee was represented by two members, and because they did not have a quorum, they did not take action. They indicated that they may be meeting this Thursday to take a vote. The two members who were present were in favor of making this adjustment. Again, the overall goal here is to improve our quality of service to the residents relative to the budget process and town meeting. And I'm available now to answer any questions you may have.
I'll start here.
I like that, you know, normally when a subordinate comes in front of you and asks you to go over the schedule, you're asking for more time. But I like that you're actually asking for less time. I think that's very amicable. You think that all these time frames are very doable?
Yes.
Through your hard work?
I think as we've learned over the years, the town committees, boards, and commissions do a great job preparing for the budget process, and the department heads as well as staff are ready to move this forward, this process forward, expeditiously.
Good.
Yeah.
That's right.
I think it's a great proposal. This is the first time I've been on the inside of the budget process, so to Mr. Tedstone's point, how this is going to actually work for the people that have to scramble to meet these earlier deadlines, I don't know about that, but certainly being on the outside looking in, I came to a few of the selectmen's meetings towards the end of the year before town meeting, and I was shocked that I think the meeting before, right, the last meeting before a town meeting, they were scrambling to get, you know, everything in order. I couldn't believe it, how last minute it ended up being. And in the course of the year, I also, talking to a lot of residents, noticed that a lot of people in the public felt there wasn't an adequate opportunity or mechanism for the public to either be involved or have input or be better informed. So, you know, I notice you have a greater public information or participation aspect to this. I think that's very healthy, and I think there's a real desire for that on the part of citizens. So I hope it works. I think it's a great idea.
Well, as you'll see from the inside, there's always the opportunity for the public to see, but now we're just trying to get it all done a little earlier. My only questions are, what if we okay this schedule and the school department comes back and says, uh-uh? Or some of the other departments come back and say, uh-uh.
That may happen. I can assure you that the schedule that you see in front of you is based on extensive discussions with all parties so far. From our discussions with Kathy and Ralph, our goal was to work within the framework that the school committee has set for its process already. There will be a need for them to adjust perhaps one or two meetings. And I'm looking forward to the discussion on Thursday to receive the school committee's feedback.
And then my only other question is, even though we're doing this to give people more time and to make it easier for people to have input, will we be in violation of the charter?
I don't believe so. I think when we put this schedule together, our goal was to make sure that we work and stay and remain within the limits that are set by the charter. Our deadlines are just simply earlier than the charter.
Yeah, I just don't want to have it, you know, no good deed goes unpunished. You know, we're trying to do it better, but the charter says, no, we have to slow down or something. Okay, great.
Yeah.
Do you need a motion on this?
Yes, that would be helpful if the board could make a motion subject to the Appropriations Committee's positive approval as well as concurrence from the school committee. Though, as I said, under the charter, the votes that are required are from the Appropriations Committee and the Board of Selectmen. However, because we are one town, always looking for one solution, we want to make sure that the school department is also on board.
Excellent. So the chair will entertain a motion to accept the new budget and capital process dates subject to the other boards and committees.
Second. So moved.
Second.
Any further discussion? All those in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Opposed? Abstain? Motion carries. Thank you, Mr. Kamala.
Thank you.
What else do you have for us?
Elaine will introduce the next topic with your permission, Mr. Chair.
Thank you. So what I've distributed this evening with the packet is an update to the Hopkinton Business Guide, which is a guide to permits and licenses. The original document was created back in 2005 when we had an Economic Development Commission, and they compiled the document and they handed it over to the town for maintenance and updating in the future. So the last update was in 2012, and I've updated it this year based on changes in regulatory frameworks, policies, and so forth, updating the website references, the staff listings, and also adding in the vision that the town created a year ago. Thought that was important to state in this. And so this will become available on the town website, and we always have them available at the Land Use Department on the third floor, and we typically go through maybe 10 a month. People do pick them up when they come up to get permits and ask questions about opening up businesses and obtaining permits. So what you have is an update to that that handy business guide that I think people do use.
Elaine, I have just one question. When I was looking at the miscellaneous practitioners' licenses and permits, is there anything, do we have any regulation in town on those Airbnb?
We do not, but it's one of the topics that someone has suggested that the Zoning Advisory Committee look at this year.
Not that I don't know if Hopkinton's a big vacation spot for people, but
we have heard of people
doing
that.
This is great. This is, you know, this is another one of those documents that just shows that you know, Hopkinton really can be open for business, and this is something that was really needed to be updated. Thank you. I really appreciate it. This is great. It's very succinct, tight. Everything's in there.
Happy to see it. It's great this time around, and the original is just as good.
Thanks so much. Mr. Kamala, anything else?
Yes. I have the final request in which I'm respectfully asking the Board of Selectmen to authorize the town manager to procure leased office space for Park and Recreation Department. Here is the reason why I'm making the request. You may recall that 3-4 years ago, the town put together a review of town facilities, which was done by the Permanent Building Committee. That process identified and made recommendations with regards to what town facilities were meeting their design goals and functionality. At that time, the report indicated that whilst there was not an immediate need to expand town hall, the report did identify that in the medium term, which is where we are now, there will be a need to find additional space for town hall staff. I can share with the board and the residents that at this point, there are several departments that are really struggling for space. Let me walk you through the building. On the first floor, we have additional staff in the finance department. And currently, we have staff who are sharing offices. We have the accounting manager in the same office as the finance director. We have the principal assessor in a cubicle. And we all know that as the principal assessor, oftentimes he is called upon to have confidential discussions. We also have the support staff in an open area where they are really working in close proximity. I think we should commend them for their efforts in making everything work. I think one thing that stands out, and I remember recently I was walking through the building with one of the board members, and I pointed out to them that clearly if you are in that working area and there's somebody who's requesting service at the counter or who's being attended to at the counter and a couple phones rings in that area, it simply becomes difficult to hear. And if you walk across to the HR office, we have 3 positions in the HR department and 2 offices. That's the office where our retirees, current employees, are always having conversations that require privacy. And right across the corridor is the park and rec department. The office measures 12 by 14 feet. and we have 3 employees working in that space. Keep in mind, Park and Rec Department is about serving the public. I tell Jay and his team that I'm always happy to see a queue of, you know, a line of, what is happy to see residents lining up to register for programs. That's what we want the program to be doing. However, conducting that kind of business in very tight quarters is not good quality customer service. And keep in mind too, this is a program that has a lot of resources that they use as part and parcel of delivering their services. They have basketballs, they have footballs, they have tennis rackets, and so forth. And all of that stuff is crammed into a 12 by 14 office where we use the office as storage, we use it as normal office, we also use it as the counter for conducting service. It's always tough seeing customers sitting down there trying to write checks when in fact there's no space on the desk to be writing the check. So with that in mind, I have been in conversation with the director as well as the chair, and we have identified what could help. Specifically, 1,000 square feet to 1,500 square feet would work. A location in the downtown area which gives the program visibility as well as easy access to the facilities that they run, as well as a central location that continues the close working relationship between Park and Rec and the other town departments. These are the requirements that we've laid out for this space. Based on the going office space rate in town, this could cost the town anything between $24,000 to $35,000 a year. So this is the request, and the chair as well as the other member of the Park and Rec Commission are here to answer any questions alongside me that the board may have.
Do you guys want to come up? Mr. Tedstone, do you have any questions?
I do, as usual. So the lease for this office space, who's going to pay for the lease? Under whose budget is this lease?
Yes, specifically the town will pay for this lease. This would be the first year we're doing it. We always approve things on a year-to-year basis. In FY16, my recommendation is that the town pays. In FY17, sorry, that the town pays for this space.
And it would be our hope that if we did this, it would just be a temporary fix until we got a new school built or something. We're not looking to spend $24,000 to $35,000 a year for the next 200 years. We're looking to get, this is going to be a temporary thing until there's a building that's available to house the Parks and Rec Department, correct?
That is correct, and I can share with you that the chair of the Park and Rec Commission made that a clear condition when we had this conversation.
We'd like to thank the town manager for his assistance in helping find a space, because he does accurately represent the cramped quarters that we have downstairs. That office was great when it was only used part-time from 10 to 2 with 2 employees, and since then we have 1 full-time person and 2 part-time, and as he's pointed out very accurately, people are writing checks and filling out quarry forms, bouncing around the basketballs. Our commission met soon after our walkthrough of a couple properties, and it was our commission's vote and determination that this would be a great temporary fix for a year or two, and to what you've suggested, Brendan, that center school or a facility larger that we could go ahead and occupy. It was also important to note that the commission voted for this to be a cost neutral proposition to our fiscal year budget, recognizing that we want to be fiscally responsible to our constituents and not double our office space. So the fact that the town manager has offered to pick up the lease and any extra expenses that wouldn't affect our budget is right in keeping with what our commission voted.
Just one more question. As I walked up and I took a look at the football field and everything today, took a walk through those grounds. And when I walked by, I looked at the old AA building, the building behind the tennis courts. You know, is there a reason that we don't explore using that?
If you're referencing the white building, that building is actually used by the school facilities department. It's actually occupied.
Fully?
I believe so.
I've been in there several times, working with hanging banners and things, and it's I wouldn't say it's cramped quarters, but there's not a lot of excess space that I could see just casually. But we are open to other suggestions.
Yeah, I look at that building and I think it's good because it's close to everything that Parks and Rec does. And I know that our building and grounds, Al Rogers has his office in there. I don't know who else has an office in there. Yeah. And if it's just a matter of some storage, then it would be cheaper to rent a storage facility than it would be to rent an office space.
I believe the administrative assistant is also in that office, Mrs. Carter.
But I also suggest that for that property, as we go, we have people that come in and out and write checks and come in to ask questions about programs and sign CORI forms and apply for jobs and all that. The parking situation at the high school is really difficult, and I can't imagine where the extra three or four people would park at any point in time.
Good point.
Yeah, with the water tanks all chained off too right there. There's no extra parking at all. Ms. Wright.
I have two questions. Do you have a place in mind? But before that, what would the viability of that, most of that basement floor level be minus the storage space area, and then taking your existing Parks and Rec room and converting that into a conference room? Because it seems like the basement is largely, minus the storage, used as another meeting room area.
I can speak to the basement. Thanks to Dave Del Torio and his team's efforts, it's now much more habitable. However, given the history of flooding, given the history of dampness in the area, I wouldn't suggest the basement is an appropriate full-time office space for now, for any department.
Well, I mean, I know it's not the most pleasant space, and I know it has had its problems, but I also know that until we built a senior center, that functioned for years as our senior center. They served lunches there and, you know, not permanent, not for 10 years, but if we are looking at a solution that wouldn't cost the town any money, that would give them some more elbow room, you know, I'm not opposed to this, but looking at what resources we have right now, it's a fairly large space, and most of the year it's been serviceable. So I just think it's something that might be worth investigating for a short term. But did you have another site identified in the downtown area?
The town manager has assisted us in touring the site, much to our liking. But I think it would be unfair at this particular point to point out what it is until the negotiations go further.
Okay. Okay. So I'm sitting in for the chairman, who is a tight fiscal conservative. Now we're talking about the, protecting the Parks and Rec budget. And you guys have been beaten up for the last 3 years, enterprise, how much do you spend, how much are you saving, and all of this stuff. And it's great that the town's picking up the 24 to 35K a year, but that's one pocket to another pocket. And, you know, what I just want to know is there any other building in town that we can use that we're already paying for? You know, are we allowed to ask the fire chief or the police chief or the schools? You know, are we allowed to ask any other department, you know, do you have a an extra 1,000 square feet or 500 square feet that they can help us out with. You know, the building, the Todaro building, or the Irvine Todaro building, some of those things. Are any of those, could any of those be acceptable? Because one of the things I'm afraid to do is get involved in a long-term lease and have the Parks and Rec miss out on something that happens at center school, which is something that we're gonna, actually I'll add that for a future agenda item, that we start discussing that, because we know the drop dead date for that is July of 2018. So we should really start the repurposing of that. But is there, you know, if you can prove to me that we've exhausted all town buildings and such.
I think we can comment on the Todaro property, because we did tour that most recently with Dave DeTorio, and we are able to take advantage of the garage space to eliminate one of our containers for the bike racks and some of our equipment. From Dave's advice, the building would need quite a bit of refurbishment from an odor, and it's been empty for quite some time. And it's a little bit more removed from a couple of the other properties we are looking at, which are right adjacent to some of our fields, which
well,
we thought
EMC.
Was pretty good.
It's close to EMC Park. Yeah.
Correct, but to your point, we've started the search. We certainly would rely on the town manager to maybe investigate some other spots, and then of course check with the staff to see if their present location is amenable versus a basement, because that was introduced several years ago, which wasn't, it was early in my tenure and it wasn't received very favorably, but times change.
Yeah, I just want to make sure that Parks and Rec doesn't get beat up at town meeting when people are up there saying, we're talking about the enterprise fund, they're supposed to be self-sustaining, et cetera, and then we're adding this other number on there.
And I think, I mean, to your point, Mr. Chairman, I think this is why the commission voted, and I understand a bucket to a bucket, but this is why this commission voted that the 10-year of that lease, which would be a year or two, because this isn't anywhere a long-term solution, would be cost neutral to our department.
For the duration of the lease?
Which we suspect is going to be a year or two, and that was some of the initial conversations we had with the landlord.
So, with that, where are we finding this money?
We are always looking for efficiencies in our budget implementation, and we believe through the combined efforts of multiple town departments we'll be able to cover this cost.
Okay, so I guess as long as there's I'm comfortable as long as we have we don't get stuck into a long lease, and it's acceptable to the Parks and Rec Department. And if it's in, and through your explanation, it's absolutely necessary. But what now, wait a minute, so we just did this for Parks and Rec. What's gonna happen? You just mentioned a few with the finance department and others that are bursting at the seams. Are we going to have to, in a couple months, say, oh, I need another 25, 30K for finance, need another 25 or 30K for town clerk, et cetera, et cetera. Is there a long range plan for, you know, we're now in the mid plan for expansion of town hall. Is there a long range plan to figure out what we're going to do with other departments and such?
Yes, we do have a long range plan. Through the Permanent Building Committee, we identified an opportunity for an addition to the rear of Town Hall. We're not asking for that at this point. In terms of other departments that may require additional space in the near term, Youth and Family Services, they will. I'm currently in discussions with Dave Del Torio to see how the town could address a requirement that is contained in one of the DEP approvals for the wastewater treatment facility, I believe. That requirement is that the town will demolish the Fruit Street building as soon as we move the DPW offices to Wood Street. I've spoken with Dave. Dave believes there is a solution whereby we could convert that building from oil to gas, and DEP may allow that building on that side. And so we're looking into that opportunity, and that would be the ideal relocation space for youth and family services. The other departments, clearly, we will have to find a way to accommodate them here in Town Hall. I am hoping that with the construction of the library, which comes along with additional meeting space, that we may be able to convert some of the conference rooms here at Town Hall into offices.
Now, just one more question. In your talks with Dave Del Turio, now I know that this you looked at the Irvine to Darrow building. Would the repairs to make that more habitable be more than the, if we're talking a two-year lease, a 50 to 70K price tag? Just, you know, if we put the money into it, we're talking about tearing it down and such, but at our meeting, so.
As a member of the Irvine Todaro property, as you are too, Mr. Catino, I'd just point out that preserving that building, I think, makes sense. Investing in it might not make sense because we might need to access the property through there. So making a significant investment in it right now probably doesn't make sense. Parks and Rec is thrilled that we've got some an opportunity to utilize some of that space for storage right now, but I don't know that it makes a whole lot of sense to make a significant investment in that, and you probably have to do it to get it handicapped access and just to make the place usable.
Okay. Back to the Fruit Street building. So when the new DPW is built, in theory, we have to demolish that building.
I believe so. I've been told there is a requirement in one of the DEP permits that was issued.
And now, but you just said that with the exception of maybe if we convert it from oil to gas, that they would allow that to stay?
Potentially, yes, but we'll have to discuss that with DEP.
And how long is the DEP construction project supposed to take?
The DPW process. Do you mean the DPW facility? The schedule is that most likely the project will be complete by late fall next year.
So is there a reason we couldn't put people down in Fruit Street until then? Save $50,000 on a, or $35,000 on a lease?
There is no space in the coming 12 months at Fruit Street because
DPW will be there.
DPW is moving to Fruit Street, and we already have facilities in that building.
Yeah, but could we look at checking with DEP to see if that so we know ahead of time what we can, you know, whether we're going to keep it or not? That would be a great thing to do, and then maybe do the conversion while DPW is there to oversee it.
And that's a goal that has been given to the facilities department, including applying for a grant for the conversion, if possible.
So you're both comfortable?
Yes.
Okay.
We appreciate the time.
Great.
I guess I just got to add, I know you guys don't want to be in the basement. Nobody likes the basement. I'm still looking at a totally serviceable space, and I know you commented that it was damp, but I'm just looking to all the years that was our senior center. I don't know, was senior lunch ever canceled? Were they not able to ever have their, I'm still seeing a large amount of square footage right in this building where people don't have to go all the way down to Fruit Street to register their kids or whatever, that as far as, I don't remember coming in at any time and seeing a sign on the stairs saying you can't go downstairs, there's puddles today. I do want to make sure that we make wise use of the space we have, and I'm still not completely understanding why that's not ideal, but it's not a serviceable area to meet the need temporarily.
Honestly, my conversations with the senior center staff, mm-hmm. Indicate that they did have concerns working in the basement location. I also, I think the board has charged the town manager to engage employees and make sure that the quality of life for the employees here in the office is acceptable. And clearly, we all know the basement has been wet for a while. We know the town has invested, and Dave has done a great job in bringing it to a level where it's dry. However, I know that in the past year, there have been a couple instances where water has come through. For me, it's acknowledging that we have employees who work very hard. It's employees who, in fact, in the case of the park and rec department, these are employees who are not here because they want more money. These are employees who are here because they are committed and have worked with us in accepting remuneration packages that work with our budget. And so in that regard, I think it's in our best interest to make sure that we give them working quarters that are functional and that are comfortable. And at this point, I don't believe the basement is at that level.
Claire, if this is a concern and you'd like us to poll the employees and the commission members, we'll have a meeting next week Wednesday to see if that might be amenable space to the town manager's suggestion. But when that was suggested a number of years ago, they decided they may again decide to stay in their present office space just because of the close quarters, but it would be more comfortable for them. Mm-hmm. than the we could call it subterranean in that basement, yeah, make no, it look a little more attractive.
Does any other department rent space? Will this be the first one?
The school department does.
Right, I understand, right across the street.
And to your earlier question, we have also looked at other town facilities. The fire station, through the efforts of the fire chief, the HR department, we're now diversifying the workforce in that department. And there are needs that are coming up because we are now working with both male and female firefighters. So clearly the fire station will be needing additional space to make those accommodations. We have had discussions with the police chief in terms of accessing additional space. There are limitations relative to the current configuration of the building, as well as some of the mechanical and plumbing issues that we're currently trying to address through a grant that Dave sourced for the town. So that space is not immediately available.
But we could look into, because I know that there is some expansion space in that building. Put a separate entrance in or something like that for other departments maybe use.
It's an option.
Good, great, thanks. We're just looking for options. Just looking before we spend the money. But, the chair will entertain a motion for the, to allow the town manager to negotiate a short-term lease for Parks and Rec to get some additional space.
So moved.
Second.
Any further discussion? All those in favor? Aye. Opposed? Abstained? Okay, Mr. Town Manager, do your best negotiating.
Thank you. And the board's comments are well taken. We will continue to work with Dave to make the basement much more habitable. Our goal has been to at least identify a couple of town hall functions that could move to the basement in mind are the following: storage and a kitchen area and conference rooms. If we can get to that point and include offices as well, we will look into that option. I can share with you that there is one department that has said they may be willing to go to the basement, but clearly their expectation is that we will bring it to a much more habitable level than where we are now.
I would just add, I guess the reason I'm just sitting here feeling a little reticent is I think it's a good thing that we're always raising our standards. It is, I remember when we tried to get the senior center, how long it took for the town to finally give a center for the seniors, and they waited and suffered, if you will, through that basement senior center for many, many years. There is an implication that it is totally an unacceptable space for any employees, but somehow it was not unacceptable for the seniors. And that's why I have a hard time completely accepting that what was tolerable for our seniors for so many years is suddenly not intolerable on a temporary basis. And there may be, have been more problems that have occurred with this area in recent years. And also we're raising our standards, and that's a good thing. But I just want to explain where I'm coming from, why I'm feeling that way.
Well said.
And as one more off-topic conversation point on that, I would like to commend you guys for the quality of work that the Parks and Rec has done. For the last 2 years, my kids have been to the camp, I don't know, every week that it was offered, just about. And counselors were great, activities were great, everything was great, very transparent, everything was great. And you guys did a great job, and Jay and the entire staff should be commended for the work that they did.
We appreciate your compliment and the town support. A little bit of news, again, just a little off topic as well. The board voted last night to go ahead and temporary light the two Fruit Street turf fields to help accommodate the school and their fields that are, because of the drought, are in such condition. So it's good for the town to know that there'll be additional playing time on the investment that we all made.
Awesome.
Well, so appreciate your support and the good words.
And that plastic is still green despite the drought.
Bob,
for the most part,
there's no office space in that building at Reed Park that you guys could use, right?
Actually, we're asking for that building to be condemned.
Really?
So we could get support to go ahead and take it down, because CPC wouldn't fund that. Okay. But we're always thinking.
All right. Outside the box.
It's a good consideration. No, Brendan, thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you very much. Okay, let's continue. Any future?
I got nothing.
Okay. Well, I'd like to look into continue this building discussion and look at start talking about repurposing the center school.
Absolutely.
A little bit ahead of time.
I actually do have something.
Yes.
I'd like to look into something like a committee, put together a committee for this for the fields, whether for the football and things like that, for everything that's gone on these last couple of weeks with the drought. And I don't particularly think that the end result of the reason that the football team isn't playing on that field is because of the drought that we've had for the last couple of weeks. I believe that there's this whole system needs to be blown up and relooked at, and you know, maybe throw a master plan together, a committee, have them, you know, put a committee together, meet, report back to the Board of Selectmen in a month on the state of all the fields, and then maybe even look into going into have all the fields be under the management of one person, and go from there.
Well, we have to discuss that with this school still control.
Absolutely, but it's a stone we need to turn, because I know that Hopkinton is very rich on its high school football, and there's a lot of people right now that are playing their senior year of high school football in another town, which is not going to bode well for the next 30 or 40 years, the night before Thanksgiving at Cornell's.
Well said. Okay, with that, the chair will entertain a motion to adjourn.
So moved.
Second.
Any further discussion? All those in favor? Aye.
Aye.
Thank you very much, everybody.
Thank you.